Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stolen Years, Stories of the Wrongfully Imprisoned, by Reuven Fenton. Narrated by J.D. Jackson, Will Damron, and Bahni Turpin. Forward. March 2014. When, at the age of 29, I was wrongly convicted of a triple murder in Paterson, New Jersey, I just narrowly escaped the electric chair. I was given life in prison instead. Because I might have been executed for something I didn't do, I have staunchly opposed capital punishment to this day. Who knows how many people have been executed for crimes they did not commit? In an imperfect system run by human beings, and what system isn't, errors are inevitable. Capital punishment is a perfect punishment. An eye for an eye. But you cannot have a perfect punishment in an imperfect system. Nothing illustrates the imperfection of the system more than wrongful convictions. They are the absolute bane of the justice system. In this gripping book, Reuven Fenton shows us the devastating consequences that arise when one is convicted for a crime he or she did not commit. These stories have happy endings. Sadly, most do not. The causes of miscarriages of justice crop up again and again. A case is not safe in the presence of overworked and poorly prepared defense attorneys, false science, the youth of a defendant and his or her criminal history, racial prejudice, unreliable witnesses, and especially the absence of hard evidence proving the defendant is innocent. Many of these cases become constructs of the prosecutors, damning stories that may persuade a jury to convict while the defense attorney is asleep at the wheel. And this is where the real problem lies. Every officer of the court is ethically bound to the truth, but not every officer of the court can resist the urge to further his or her career with a string of convictions, whether or not these convictions comply with the truth. It is precisely when winning or losing becomes the be-all and end-all that truth is disregarded and justice becomes elusive. I disagree with those who say tunnel vision by prosecutors causes wrongful convictions. Tunnel vision sounds like a disease or condition that prosecutors suffer from and cannot control. The only one suffering is the convicted person. My view is that the real cause of wrongful convictions is willful blindness, and that's something most defendants never imagine is possible. People like Cornelius Dupree naively believed the truth would set you free. Truth, my friend, wouldn't be recognized if she sashayed into the courtroom and sat smack dab in the judge's lap. Once the defendant is found guilty, the real problems start. He or she is now buried under a deep, deep pile of procedural shit. That shit is there to protect the conviction and the people who perpetrated it. It sometimes takes decades to dig oneself out, but not without DNA evidence or another murderer or rapist admitting to the crime. A body for a body, as district attorneys like to say. Even then, it's no slam dunk. So the ambitions and reputations of the legal officers play a huge role in the failings of the system. That's why we hear about Brady violations, instances in which prosecutors deliberately hide evidence favorable to a defendant. And the prosecutors often do it post-conviction. Why would they do such a thing if not to protect the reputations of the people who conspired in the original conviction? I see a world where reputations are enhanced by admitting to error and by working for the truth. The system would not be perfect, but it would sure be a whole lot better. What then do men and women do when they are sent to prison for something they have not done? To every human being in prison, guilty or innocent, I would say that it all depends upon attitude. The physical body is the vehicle in which we traverse life, but our attitude is our steering wheel. In prison, people find themselves at the bottom of human existence. What a prisoner must say is, "Okay, whatever I've done in life has led me to where I am today. Therefore, if I want to get out of prison and stay out, I've got to turn around and go back the other way." Prisoners must use this time to learn how to read if they don't know how, to learn to write, to learn a skill if they've never had one. Maybe on the outside they didn't have time for any of these things. Now they do. This time has been imposed upon them. They must use it to look at themselves, to make themselves indispensable, to awaken. I see myself in some of the former inmates profiled in this book, like Devin Ayers of the Bronx, who wrongfully went to prison for murder. "Prison changed me into a better person," he says, and I know what he means. Although it wasn't the foul prison that did it, it was Devin. That being said, self-improvement is the prisoner's responsibility. The prisoner's responsibility has nothing to do with the awesome responsibility of those who run the system. What is their responsibility? To just aim for the truth. Not a conviction, not a verdict, not a win, nor a loss. Just the truth. If the conviction was found to be wrong, they must recognize it and admit it. They must not fool themselves into believing that protecting a wrongful conviction serves justice, truth, or anything but themselves. If they reduce the barriers to the truth, they will relieve terrible human suffering, individual by individual. That's a good thing. Take it from me. Prison is suffering, and prison without justice is crucifixion. To live in a world where truth matters and justice, however late, really happens, would be heaven right here on earth. Heaven on earth. Dr. Reuben Hurricane Carter, May 6th, 1937, to April 20th, 2014.
Preface. Go to the precinct. Those are all the instructions a reporter at a New York City tabloid needs to hear from an editor to know that he or she has been assigned a perp walk. A perp walk is when cops walk the accused out of the station house in cuffs and put him in a squad car to take him to court. It's a quick and chaotic mess. Photographers try not to trip over each other as they attempt to get a decent shot, while the reporters shout questions at the perp from the outer edges of the scrum. I've been assigned perp walks for as long as I've been a reporter for the greatest tabloid in the world, the New York Post. The walks are almost always preceded by hours of waiting, as detectives work the perp over and over in an interrogation room. If it's a particularly high-profile case, someone collared for pushing some poor guy onto the subway tracks right before the E-train barreled past, for instance, then a lot of other reporters and camera people wait with you. Empty coffee cups pile up at our feet. The wind shifts. Precinct detectives start giving us little nods when they come outside for smoke breaks. Representatives from the NYPD's Public Information Office show up. And then it happens. Flanked by a detective on each side, the perp exits the station and walks down the steps into a tidal wave of flashing lights and reporters belting out questions like, "Why did you do it?" Usually he keeps his head down and says nothing. But sometimes he looks straight into the throng. I've seen a few perps smile, like they're enjoying their 15 seconds of fame. And every once in a while, they say a few words. "I didn't do nothing." When it's all over, the consensus among the reporters and cameramen is, "Yeah, sure you didn't." There's an assumption when someone gets arrested, especially for something really grim like murder or child molestation, that the accused is guilty. You look at the person's mugshot, see those bleary eyes and messed up hair, and say to yourself, guilty. It's human intuition. Often this intuition is spot on. Some crimes happen in front of dozens of witnesses or are caught on surveillance tapes. Sometimes the perpetrator's fingerprints are all over the crime scene. Sometimes he's caught with the victim's blood literally on his hands. But sometimes there are no witnesses and no solid evidence to match the accused to the crime. And it eats at you as you wonder just what if the perp is innocent. Because innocent or not, they all bury their faces in their hands the same way when they hear the jury foreman say, guilty. Nobody, not even a cold-blooded killer, wants to sit in prison for the rest of his life. On the flip side, stories I'm getting assigned increasingly often these days are about exonerations. It's a whole event. Reporters pack the courtroom to catch the look on the inmate's face as the judge tells him, you are free to go. And then comes the best part, when he walks to the gallery and tearfully embraces his now-grown children for the first time as a free man. At the press conference afterward, the delirious exoneree tries to field questions that are impossible to answer in a soundbite. How does it feel to be free? They'll ask. It feels amazing, he'll say. But I always want to know more. I want to know how awful the prison food was, and how tiny the cells were, and how much the prison scrubs itched. And how did it feel when his kids stopped visiting and answering his letters? And what was it like trying to rebuild a life from scratch after getting thrust back into a world that had changed so much? This book is my attempt to answer those questions and many others through the voices of 10 remarkable individuals who've been to the worst kind of hell and back. These men and women bared their souls to me and opened my eyes to the horrible plight of the incarcerated innocent. I have been as thorough a scribe as possible, quoting these folks extensively from hundreds of hours of interviews. I have culled additional material for this book from thousands of pages of court documents and media reports, as well as from information provided to me by the lawyers who represented these extraordinary people. I hope I have given them their due. I owe these 10 exonerees an enormous debt of gratitude for their patience as I peppered them with endless questions that ranged from the philosophical to the mundane. Several of them told me they'd started having nightmares again from reliving the horror with me. But their stories need to be told. Introduction. For 19-year-old Cornelius Dupree, the skip from freedom to lockup was so fast, so sudden, so random that the reality didn't sink in until he was known as inmate number 308310. The Dallas teen had been walking with a friend to a party when the two were stopped and frisked by police officers looking for suspects in a robbery-rape case. Dupree and his friend were arrested, falsely identified as the perpetrators, charged, jailed, tried, convicted, and finally sentenced to 60 years in prison. From the day he was arrested, Dupree didn't know freedom for 31 years. Drayton Witt was still mourning the passing of his 5-month-old adopted son, Stephen, when cops arrested the Arizona man for shaking the child to death. At trial, it didn't seem to matter that Stephen had been in and out of the hospital for seizures since birth. Nor did it matter that the incriminating medical research on shaken baby syndrome was dubious at best. Witt did 10 years behind bars. Deborah Brown, a Utah mother of three, took a drive one day to check on her ailing buddy, Lael. She found him dead from a gunshot wound to the head and called the cops hysterical. The ensuing investigation found Brown to be the chief suspect because, well, she and Lael had hung out a lot, she had the key to his house, and she'd swung by with soup the day before she found his body. No actual evidence connected her to the crime. She was locked up for 18 years. That's how these things go sometimes. The stories in this book are about your worst nightmare come to life. The kind of nightmare where one day you're just a face in the crowd, and the next you're notorious, wearing jail scrubs and sitting in a cell waiting to be tried. And it just gets worse from there. The stories presented here are full of heartbreak and betrayal and violence. But more than anything, they are about hope and redemption, about 10 amazing people who fended off the blackest kind of despair to keep fighting for freedom. These 10 exonerees are among the more than 1,400 people who were released from prison since 1989 after being found wrongfully convicted. There is no doubt that this is just a small fraction of innocent people who have been incarcerated during that time. Still, it's encouraging that the number of exonerations has increased annually. There were 21 exonerations in 1989 and 91 in 2013. The increase is owed to the growing number of innocence organizations springing up across the country. Each exoneration brings more awareness to the problem, which gets more public eyes focused on the police and prosecutors whose overly aggressive tactics, bad evidence, or misconduct put innocent people away. As you are listening to this, an impossible-to-document number of wrongly convicted people are sitting in prison, and only a small fraction will ever get out. If this book helps fuel a burgeoning conversation about lives destroyed by our win-at-all-costs criminal justice system, I've done my job. Chapter 1. Damon Thibodeau, Louisiana, 15 years. Damon Thibodeau yawns. It's 6 in the morning, and he's just woken from a dreamless sleep. He gazes at the ceiling for a few seconds before hoisting himself up. It's so cramped in here, putting on a shirt and pants is a Harry Houdini magic trick. The walls barely fit his 5'9", square-shouldered body. He's a Doberman living in a doghouse built for a dachshund. Once dressed and washed up, he sits and gazes ahead. He cracks a smile, because he is so tickled by what he does not see, a concrete wall with steel bars in the foreground. Instead, through the windshield of his truck, he sees a sky so brilliantly blue it's the very color of exhilaration. And where the sky meets the horizon, asphalt, beautiful, sparkling, and stretching for 1,000 miles. After a quick breakfast eaten high in the driver's seat of his big rig, he turns the key, puts his foot on the clutch and shifts into gear, and starts watching the world unfold. For Thibodeau, the best scenery is the kind that's always moving. I've seen just about every state in the continental U.S., he says. I've been over the Rockies, 7, 8 times? The view never gets boring. I've been through Arizona, Nevada, over the Appalachians, the Ozarks. They call it hauling freight, but as far as I'm concerned, I get paid to travel the country. For 15 years, nothing moved. Thibodeau was a death row inmate in solitary confinement at Louisiana State Penitentiary, better known as Angola, or Alcatraz of the South, where days bore little difference from weeks, and weeks from months, and months from years. Thibodeau calls that time one big black hole in his life. The thing is, a lot of guys try to fill that hole, Thibodeau says. I'm not going to try to fill it because you can't fill it. It's just gone. What he chooses to do is look ahead, and he can think of no better vantage point than the one he's at right now. Sure, the truck's cab makes for a cramped night's sleep, and maybe it is sort of cell-like in here. But who cares? In prison, it was the involuntary confinement, the inability to step outside to so much as take a piss in the bushes, that man was never meant to endure. It was 1996, and Damon Thibodeau felt free as a bird. He was 22 and working as a deckhand on a Mississippi River tugboat. He labored from noon to midnight, mopping the deck, securing the barge, making sure the lines were in good order. And when things had quieted down, he'd sit on the barge and watch the stars. No worries, no plans, except maybe getting a pilot's license so he could captain the boat himself one day. Thibodeau had recently come back to his hometown of New Orleans after a decade of living in Midland, Texas. When a cousin hooked him up with a deckhand job, he was glad he made the move. One Friday afternoon in July, while on leave from duty, Thibodeau visited some distant cousins, the Champagnes, in a suburb of New Orleans. One of the cousins, 14-year-old Crystal, asked him for a ride to the Winn-Dixie supermarket to buy some groceries. He didn't feel like it, so she went by herself. She didn't come back. Her mother went looking for her, then her father. As the hours passed, others joined the effort, including Thibodeau. They started with the most obvious places, the shopping center and the park where she played softball, but still no sign of Crystal. Then they expanded the search perimeter. After nearly 24 hours of nonstop searching, an exhausted Thibodeau went home to catch a few hours' sleep. He threw himself into bed and was just drifting off when he heard a pounding on his door. It was detectives from the Jefferson Parish Sheriff's Office. They wanted to ask him some questions at the office. Right around the time Thibodeau arrived at the sheriff's, a family friend named John Tomlinson found Crystal. She was dead, her body in some brush by a bridge on a bank of the Mississippi. A red wire was wrapped around her neck, her skull was fractured, and one of her front teeth had been knocked out. When word came back to the sheriff's about Crystal's death, Thibodeau felt something shift in the air. The detectives, who'd been civil and professional to that point, turned hostile. "Where were you the night Crystal disappeared?" they asked. "What were you doing that night? Did you rape her? Did you kill her?" "No," he said, and they called him a liar and started all over again. Hours passed as the pressure mounted. The detectives tried to bait Thibodeau, claiming his cousins denied he was ever at their apartment the night Crystal disappeared. Thibodeau thought he'd asphyxiate when he heard that. The cops described the pain he'd feel when his body succumbed to lethal injection to pay for what he did. His brain felt like it was melting. Then came the final blow. They strapped Thibodeau to a lie detector test, threw question after question at him, and then announced he'd failed the test. With that, Thibodeau passed out. "That's the point where I realized I was never going to walk out of here," he would say years later. By 4 a.m., the interrogation had seeped into its ninth hour, and Thibodeau's endurance ran out. Delirious with fear, exhaustion, and hunger, he confessed to killing Crystal. "At that point, I was tired," he would later tell a reporter during an interview. "I was hungry. All I wanted to do was sleep, and I was willing to tell them anything they wanted me to tell them if it would get me out of that interrogation room." He spewed out a confession that was just a regurgitation of what detectives had fed him. He'd taken Crystal under the bridge. She wanted sex, and Thibodeau was happy to oblige, but when he got too rough and Crystal begged him to stop, he punched and choked her and eventually strangled her to death with a wire from his car speaker. "I didn't know that I had done it, but I'd done it," he told his interrogators. Signed confession in hand, the detectives charged Thibodeau with murder. A few hours later, when he came to his senses, he recanted everything. But the sheriff's department wasn't handing back its prize, not even after investigators quickly unearthed details so contradictory to Thibodeau's confession that he ought to have been sent home that very day, with an apology and a fruit basket to boot. The wire around Crystal's neck was a red electrical conductor wire, not the speaker wire from Thibodeau's car that he confessed to killing her with. And, contrary to what the detectives had told Thibodeau, Crystal's mother, Dawn, told police he was in her apartment when her daughter had gone to the grocery store. At his trial, Dawn changed her story and testified that he was not in her apartment after all. Years later, she claimed she couldn't remember whether he was there or not. As he waited in jail, new holes kept forming in his confession. The autopsy revealed that Crystal had been hit in the face with a blunt object, not Thibodeau's fist, as he'd claimed. And the forensic examiner found that Crystal had not had sex for at least 24 hours before she died. No sex, no punch to the face, no speaker wire. Yet at trial, the state found creative ways to plug up those holes. In one wild instance, an expert witness explained that the lack of evidence of sex could be attributed to maggots that ate up any traces of Thibodeau's semen. Meanwhile, prosecutors painted Thibodeau as a troubled young man from a broken home, just the kind of damaged screw-up who would not only defile a 14-year-old sexually, but would kill her in cold blood. They also brought in two witnesses who had identified Thibodeau in the photo lineup as a man they'd seen standing nervously near the murder scene. Thibodeau's attorney, meanwhile, put up an uninspired defense that inexplicably failed to explain to jurors that the confession, the key piece of evidence, had been false. Thibodeau learned later on that the attorney, a former detective, had never defended a murder case before. What's more, he was applying for a job in the district attorney's office at the time of the trial. Nevertheless, Thibodeau was confident that the jury would acquit him and this nightmare would end. But on October 3, 1997, after a mere 45 minutes of deliberations, the jury filed into the courtroom and the foreman read the verdict. Guilty. I was flabbergasted, Thibodeau says. I was like, weren't you people paying attention? Even now it shocks me that people were so inattentive at my trial. The next day, the jury recommended he be sentenced to death. The New Orleans Times-Picayune story from that day was headlined, Rapist Killer Gets Death. Man Murdered Teen Step-Cousin. It quoted Crystal's father, Clifton, as saying he was glad for Thibodeau's death sentence. He deserved it. He beat my daughter so bad in the face, it's unreal. Thibodeau sat in the Jefferson Parish County Jail for 3 weeks, awaiting final word on whether the judge would accept the jury's recommendation. But he was pretty much resigned to the inevitable. It wasn't so much, oh my God, I'm gonna die, as, how am I going to survive this? He recalls thinking. I knew I had my appeals, but my question was, what's this going to be like if the justice system failed in such a terrible way? I just had a jury completely ignore the case. How am I going to prove to someone else that I didn't do it when these people who weren't paying attention think that I did? Thibodeau was brought back to court on a Friday for sentencing. Judge Patrick McCabe asked him to stand. Then he sentenced him to death, on grounds that society could not tolerate murderers of children. It's kind of a surreal moment, Thibodeau says. You watch helplessly as your life's ripped away from you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Looking back all these years later, he still can't believe that the prosecutors, those dignified servants of the state, had played the court like frat boys playing foosball. You assume that professionals, people who have gone to law school and trained to do this, wouldn't just blatantly rip someone's life apart just because they want to win, he says. That night, a deputy sheriff put Thibodeau in a squad car and set out for Louisiana State Penitentiary, a 2.5-hour drive. The sky was clear, and Thibodeau watched the stars the entire ride. All I could think about was, am I going to see the stars again? I could have thought about 100 other things, like my life, and why I had ended up here. But all I could think about was the night sky. Louisiana State Penitentiary, nicknamed Angola after the town it's in, sits at the end of State Highway 66. It spans 28 square miles, large enough to fit 5 Louisiana State University campuses. Bordered on 3 sides by the Mississippi River, there is nowhere to run but out the front gate. There's an odd beauty to the grassy, well-kept grounds, which include a golf course for employees and a 10,000-seat stadium built for the biannual Angola Rodeo, an event that attracts multitudes. There's a farm on the property, too. Angola opened in 1901 on land that had once been home to 4 slave plantations. The symbolism of that bit of history is not lost on the prisoners who work those fields today. They call it the last slave plantation. Death row inmates are exempt from such grueling work, or from doing any work at all. For 23 hours a day, they are locked up with no human contact. They get 1 hour a day outside the cell, which they use to take a shower, make a phone call, or walk up and down the tier. You have no life. You just exist, Thibodeau says. Death row is solitary confinement, completely. Every time you see someone, there's always a set of bars between you and them. It took 2.5 years before Thibodeau met his appeals lawyer, and during that time he slept and watched TV and did nothing else. If he remembers a single one of those 900-some-odd days, he remembers them all. Television was the only way I could deal with the excessive boredom. There was nothing to do. The TVs hung from the wall across from the cells, one to every four inmates. Thibodeau favored sci-fi shows like Babylon 5 and Doctor Who, but he was particularly into Star Trek in all its incarnations. Voyager, Enterprise, Deep Space Nine, The Next Generation, and the classic 1960s episodes that aired in the morning. Thibodeau would have to coordinate with his neighbors to work out a TV schedule. Some liked to watch sports all the time. Others liked to watch game shows or soap operas or reality shows. If you had a station that aired your show twice a day, you might let another inmate watch his show, and you'd watch yours later. Sometimes this didn't work out, and guys would get angry and curse at each other. Sometimes they'd get so mad they'd fling their own shit at each other. When something like that happened, the guards were not nice, Thibodeau says. They had to send an inmate orderly down to clean up the mess. They cracked down pretty hard on people who did stuff like that. To be fair, Thibodeau did a few things besides sleeping and watching TV. He'd clean his 6x9-foot cell twice a day, wiping down the jail bars, the sink and toilet, straightening out his little desk, and making his bed. Officers didn't like messy cells, and if they found a mess, they'd take your stuff. Thibodeau didn't have much to take. His footlocker held a toothbrush, three pairs of jeans, three or four sweatshirts, t-shirts, boxers, and socks. In time, a pile of legal work would start to form off to the side and eventually grow to some 2,000 pages. During his daily hour outside the cell, he'd pace back and forth on the tier. He smoked too much, and his slender frame grew flabby from the high-fat, high-sodium prison food. It was always rice and gravy-based grub, boiled hamburger patties in gravy, cooked turkey in gravy, beef in gravy, chicken in gravy. The one saving grace was the availability of greens grown on the farm. Every now and then a fight would break out on the tiers, at least they called them fights. The bars separating inmates only allowed for lightning-quick single-strike attacks. I've seen guys boil stuff in the microwave and throw it on other guys, Thibodeau says. I've seen guys standing by the bars and someone walked by and cut them with something. You probably can't kill someone on death row, but you can do some harm to him. After an attack, the administration would rotate inmates to new cells. Thibodeau always prayed to God that he would be given a cell with a fan in front of it. The temperatures were astronomical, he says. We would sometimes strip down to our boxers and sleep on the floor, which was not a whole lot cooler, maybe 2 or 3 degrees, but preferable. The mattress was some type of fire-retardant foam-type stuff wrapped in plastic. You can imagine how hot that was, how sticky it would get. Every night I would wake up in a pool of sweat because it was so hot. The mattress would be soaked. In the summertime, Thibodeau only got about an hour's sleep each night. He'd base like a slow-roasting turkey as he listened to the radio and stared out the window. The heat problem was so bad that eventually, in 2013, three death row inmates sued the penitentiary and the Louisiana Department of Public Safety and Corrections for the excessive heat, alleging that in 1 year, temperatures reached 195 degrees. Monday through Saturday, Thibodeau's life was about being drenched in sweat and nearly comatose with depression. Sunday was that too, plus something far worse. On Sundays, Angola let the tourists in to death row. Moms and dads and gaping-eyed kids who'd come to stare at this morbidly fascinating bunch of Hannibal Lecters. Before the tour began, corrections officers would instruct visitors on safety measures. Each and every inmate here is on death row for murder and is considered highly dangerous. For your safety, do not walk close to the bars. The inmates were ordered in advance to keep their mouths shut as the families asked the tour guides questions like, "What's this one in for? Why are they allowed to wear regular clothes? Shouldn't they be in jumpsuits?" I'd see fear and hatred in their eyes, and I couldn't say anything, Thibodeau recalls. "We're not monkeys in a zoo. We're human beings. I get it if they're bringing law students down to the tiers to meet their future clients or school kids. Hey, look, this is what happens if you kill somebody. But the idea of tours to the general public for profit? It's beyond sick." When the tourists came, Thibodeau tried to make like a tiger at the zoo and just ignore them. But it was impossible. Early on in his sentence, Thibodeau had listlessly filed his appeals, not because he thought it would help, but because that's what inmates do. But 2.5 years into prison, he made a resolution that he was ready to die. "I decided being on death row was a fate worse than death," he says. "There were guys around me who'd been on death row for 20, 25 years. I didn't want to be one of them. I didn't want to be old and decrepit inside a cell because of something I didn't do." In 1998, as he contemplated dropping his appeals, he got a visit from a lawyer named Denise LaBeouf, who worked with the Capital Post Conviction Project of Louisiana. "She walked in there and convinced me that she didn't think I did it, and she wanted the opportunity to prove it," Thibodeau says. "I told her I wasn't trusting of lawyers, and she understood that." Thibodeau had little hope LaBeouf would rescue him. But with nothing to lose, he became her client and saved himself from what would have effectively been suicide by passivity. That day marked the start of his slow ascent from rock bottom. The climb would take more than a decade. Thibodeau gets asked all the time how he did all those years in solitary confinement without going crazy. "I really have no answer," he says. "Call it a blessing. Call it a gift. Call it a fortunate eyes-open view of life." Well, reading the Bible was a big part of it. He read it cover to cover 4 times and still reads it today. "There are people all the time who tell me, there's no way I could have gone through what you went through. But I would look at people like Job and David and the apostles and think there's no way I could possibly have gone through what they went through. That was a big help for me." And knowing that good lawyers were working for him was paramount. After LaBeouf signed on, so did Steve Kaplan from the Minneapolis civil law firm Fredrickson and Byron. Their attitude was, "We know you're innocent, and we're going to do our best to prove it," Thibodeau says. But more than anything, he stayed sane by adhering to a strict daily routine. "I survived by repetition. Sometimes you get so bored, you don't know if you're going to lose your mind or not. So you just fall into your monotonous grind and let it envelop you." A typical day started with brewing coffee using 2 quart-sized containers and a handkerchief as a filter. Then he'd get dressed, wash his face, brush his teeth, eat breakfast, and read his Bible. He'd wipe down his cell, make the bed, fold the laundry, go through some court papers, read the Baton Rouge Advocate, watch CNN, eat lunch, listen to some blues or country music on the radio, read a few chapters of a book, usually science fiction, do some push-ups, squats, jumping jacks, and sit-ups, anything to get you sweating and your pulse up, take a shower, call his lawyers, have dinner, read some more, watch TV, do some more reading, get ready for bed, go to sleep. Day after day after day. The enemy was idleness, gaps in time when demons could get into his head, so he performed his tasks with a Marine's determination. Some days, he used his hour outside the cell to run 3 miles up and down the tier. When the weather was good, he and other inmates would go outside into individual pens equipped with basketball hoops. They'd play a game where one at a time they'd shoot a basket. The first inmate who missed would have to do 10 push-ups for every basket that was made before he missed. Sometimes Thibodeau made necklaces using silver and stone beads that he bought from a catalog. The beadwork was hypnotizing. "It gave me a way to just clear my mind and think about nothing but sticking the thread through the next bead, sticking the thread through the next bead, the next bead, the next bead." Thibodeau formed bonds with the men he shared the tier with. It did not matter to him who was innocent and who was guilty. Everyone was in for murder, and all bore the same misfortune of having been convicted in a death penalty state. "It's crazy when you think about it," he says. "You have prisons where serial murderers get to serve life sentences and be with the rest of the population because they happen to be in a state that doesn't have the death sentence." Death row inmates had an unspoken rule never to discuss their final destination. "We all knew why we were there. You just don't walk up to someone and ask, 'What do you think it will feel like when they stick the needle in you?'" When an inmate's time came, the others would watch silently as 2 officers escorted him down the tier in chains, never to return. they would never speak of it afterward. Thibodeau remembers Dobie Gillis Williams, who was 38 when he died of lethal injection on January 8, 1999. He had been convicted 15 years earlier of stabbing a woman named Sonia Nippers to death. I was in the hallway at the time when he walked by with corrections officers, in chains and a jumpsuit, and he was gone, Thibodeau says. He did not mourn. It's not an I can't believe he's gone type of thing, Thibodeau says. Everybody there is under the assumption that he and his neighbor is next in line. Nor did Thibodeau mourn the execution of Leslie Dale Martin, who was convicted of raping and murdering college student Christina Bergen in 1991. Martin took his final walk on May 10th, 2002. He was 35. He was a down-to-earth guy, Thibodeau says. He was always either reading or typing on his typewriter. I valued him as a friend. I don't know if he did it or not, he adds. That's between him and his maker. Anyway, mulling over death is a waste of time when you're busy fighting for your life. Thibodeau called his lawyers at least twice a week and did legal research every day. Death row inmates did not have access to the law library, so they would put in requests to inmate counsels every morning for certain documents, and those requests would go to the law library officers. The system was a pain in the ass. If they didn't think something you requested pertained to your case, then you wouldn't get it, Thibodeau says. Or you'd get it, but it would be the wrong document. You wanted DNA stuff? They'd pick the first DNA case they came across, which was usually nothing more than a simple rape case. Well, that did me no good, because mine was a murder case. The law says we're supposed to have access to the law library, and we don't have access to the law library. If your request is governed by an administration whose job it is to kill you, they're not going to try to help you. They're going to try to put a roadblock in your path. For a wrongful imprisonment case like Thibodeau's that had so much proof of innocence, it took a prohibitively long time to get the proof through the right channels. Even after Jefferson Parish District Attorney Paul Connick joined forces with defense lawyers in 2007 to test the DNA evidence from the crime scene, it took another 5 years before Thibodeau was finally released. Despite the growing light at the end of the tunnel, those were not happy years. You can't be happy on death row, Thibodeau says. To say someone is happy on death row is to say they're comfortable being there. I was sitting there day after day, waiting for them to just open the door and let me go. But the DA tested one piece of evidence at a time. I'm sure it would have been easier if he just sent everything together to the lab, but he's in control. So you keep your hope high, but in the back of your mind, you think maybe the DA is going to be a pain in the ass and say, no. And you have to fight anyway. So I just kept joy in a bottle until I signed the log at the front gate at the prison in the parking lot. The anticipation threw off Thibodeau's rigid daily routine that had kept his delicate psyche at bay for all those years. Everything that I put in place to help deal with the day-to-day issues of sitting in a cell all day becomes scrambled. I was trying to keep my repetitious mindset going, because if I let it deviate from my daily plan, things got thrown out of whack. Not even the Bible comforted him. What if my case falls through? He'd suddenly ask himself in the middle of reading a verse. Or if it doesn't fall through and I have to face the real world alone? That last question gave Thibodeau particular agita. It was becoming clear, as one DNA test after the next came back negative, that it stopped being an if and was now a when. What the hell am I going to do? He asked his lawyer, Steve Kaplan, one day. I have no job, no job history, no car. I'm going to have to pay rent, buy clothes, pay taxes. I have to learn to socialize with people again. Being in a cell for 15 years, you're stripped of all that. To take his client's mind off things, Kaplan sent him CDs and books, science fiction and historical works like an FDR biography and Doris Kearns Goodwin's Abraham Lincoln book, Team of Rivals. And he and Thibodeau would discuss what he read. The waiting went on and on as his lawyers slowly gathered evidence proving his innocence. They reached out to the two witnesses who'd claimed to see someone who looked like Thibodeau standing near the murder scene. The witnesses now added a crucial detail to their story. They saw police tape at the scene. This meant they were there the night searchers found Crystal's body, not the night she was killed. And they had picked Thibodeau out of a photo lineup only after seeing his image plastered all over TV. In short, they witnessed nothing of consequence. The lawyers met with state pathologist Dr. Fraser McKenzie, who had testified at Thibodeau's trial. Now, McKenzie heard for the first time that the details in Thibodeau's confession did not match the physical evidence, namely, that here was no evidence of a rape. McKenzie signed an affidavit for the attorneys, pointing out the disparities in the confession. McKenzie also determined that Crystal died about 2.5 hours after she left her home. Calculating the time Thibodeau left the Champagnes and the distance to the murder scene, it would have been virtually impossible for him to have enough time to commit the murder. Most importantly, the DNA tests, which alone had taken 2 years, did not connect Thibodeau to the crime. On September 28, 2012, Judge Patrick McCabe, who'd presided over the original trial in 1997, ordered Thibodeau be set free. He became the 300th inmate freed by DNA evidence. That morning after breakfast, a lieutenant told Thibodeau, "Pack your stuff, you're going home." "I'm already packed," he replied. But first, there was one order of business that required Thibodeau to don a jumpsuit and shackles one last time, a quick medical checkup. Until he walked out the door, he was the property of the Louisiana Department of Public Safety and Corrections. When that was done, he changed back into a pair of blue jeans and a white t-shirt. He picked up his bag and walked out of his cell and down the tier, unchained. He did not glance back. "So long," inmates called out. "Don't forget to be a voice for us." At the front gate, Thibodeau signed his name on a form. "No offense," he told the guards, "but I hope I never see you guys again." Then it was Thibodeau and the open sky, reunited. "It was kind of surreal," he says. "Here I am, looking at the sky not just as a free man, but one without chains on. It was almost euphoric. You know that feeling when you make a last payment on a car or on anything that belongs to you that you paid for in installments? Multiply that 1,000 times. Steve Kaplan was waiting outside in a rental car. They set out on a 3-day drive to Minnesota, Kaplan's home state, where Thibodeau had decided to live because of the help the state gives exonerees. During the drive, Thibodeau rolled down the window and stared for hours at the passing trees with leaves that were starting to turn brilliant reds and oranges. The air smelled wonderful. That first night, they stayed at a hotel where Thibodeau ordered a sirloin steak, well done, with asparagus and mashed potatoes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.